Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Can we have your assistance for an RPC, please? Our caller's got some sort of back pain.
So you've got some chest pains, have you?
Might be a heart attack, I'm not sure.
One of our officers has come across a lady that's been struck by a car. She's in a dangerous position on the roadway.
Oh, stand by.
This is a typical shift with West Midlands Ambulance Service.
This job is definitely not for the faint-hearted.
How quick do you reckon the car was going?
Oh, good job of that, Bob.
Every 20 seconds, they receive a call for help.
He was having some kind of seizure.
We can't hear her breathing.
From the 5.6 million people who live here.
What's your name, my lovely?
Realistically, this could be anything that you're walking into.
Unconscious, blood coming from ears.
Any chance of an overdose?
The chances of you dying are incredibly high.
Filming simultaneously with 8 paramedic crews.
That's not a good sign.
If you rise for me, mate. If you rise for me.
This is life on the front line.
If an ambulance doesn't get there, the bottom line is people could die.
Every day, this fleet of ambulances and their crews need to be ready to respond to any medical emergency. It's a Friday morning, and the topic of conversation turns to the food our paramedics can't stand.
Most disgusting food I have ever eaten. So many people have struck by it, I can't stand cucumber.
Cucumber!
This is what I mean. I literally can't stand cucumber.
I love cucumber. No. I can't believe that's the most disgusting food you've ever eaten.
No, can't stand it.
You know my relationship with baked bean.
I know you don't like a baked bean. There's a lot I don't like a baked bean, actually.
Horrendous.
It's a look.
Everything
about a baked bean is genuinely like revolting. Do you know why you should
have a baked bean? Well, the beans contaminate the whole plate. Oh, I don't like soggy food. No.
Weirdest and probably the worst is I've had frog legs and I have eaten I can't remember the name of the insect. Really, really
bugging
me.
Insect bugging me.
I didn't even try that. I like
it. She's really good at her job. I do like working with Michelle. Things she comes out with sometimes, just very, very funny.
Oh, look at that little dog.
Oh, it's a little Frenchie. Oh, I made a dog jump.
I did. I know Mandy really loves working with me. Yeah, I think she likes me.
Nice lady. Sometimes, Michelle.
Patient's breathing, patient's conscious.
Yep.
So can I help?
Can we have your assistance for an RPC, please?
For any entrapment or rollover?
Not that we're aware of. Our caller's got some sort of back pain.
5905.
Two car RPC, 738
off,
highway zone route. Yeah, we are mobile. Nothing's actually coming. We've got the address, but nothing actually details have come through on the FDT, but we have got the address on the wrong route.
So when an RTC comes in, our initial thoughts are how many vehicles are involved, how many patients there could be, and what sort of road it's happened on, whether it's the motorway or whether it's just a normal A or B road.
5 potential casualties, car versus car, highways attending. 1 patient has back pain, potential 4 others.
We can go to somewhere where the car looks a complete write-off, but the person's out and walking about. And the other extreme is you could go somewhere where the car looks like it's hardly been touched, but the person's very poorly inside, so it is very variable.
Come on.
Two cars are completely blocking both lanes of the northbound M42.
Hello, tactical commander.
Hey,
I'm all right.
Good. This is Elizabeth.
Hello, Elizabeth.
61 years old.
Hi, Elizabeth.
Elizabeth, the driver of the red Volvo, has been in a collision with a white Audi. To help ease her pain, Elizabeth has been given paracetamol intravenously. Mandy and Michelle must make sure there are no injuries to her neck or spine before attempting to move her.
Right, any pain when I'm pressing down here, sweetheart? No. So it's all your lower back?
Yeah.
The neck is a very important part of the body. We have our spinal cord and everything, all the nerves going down through it, and it can be very vulnerable in an RTC, so that's why it's one of the first things that we will check to make sure there's no damage.
Were you on the way home, were you, Elizabeth?
A therapist about my back.
Oh. Just take it nice and slowly, Elizabeth. It is Elizabeth, isn't it? I'm telling you by the right name.
We're not going to pull you, but you're quite welcome to pull on Mandy.
As Elizabeth has back problems from a previous car accident, Mandy and Michelle move her carefully to the waiting stretcher.
She expresses that she's got some lower back pain. It's a pain that she has suffered for a long time, so it was just trying to establish whether it was worse than normal, which could be due to the accident. Just take your time.
Sorry.
No, don't say sorry. It's fine.
I'm just bringing this up so it's upright for you. How's right. That?
Put that on there.
Just pop that there a minute. I have switched it off. I switched it off for now, Mandy.
Get these on.
Elizabeth may have had a lucky escape, but Mandy and Michelle know she could have internal injuries from the force of the collision that aren't immediately obvious.
Bit bumpy, sorry. Did you feel like you spun round?
Yeah, I did spin.
Yeah, you did.
I just didn't know what was happening. It was such a shock.
I think anybody in an RTC, the noise of the accident and the fact that you're not in control of your car anymore, you just don't know where it's going to stop or what's going to happen. It must be very scary.
It just reminded me of the other accident where I broke my back.
Is that in the car? Was that in the car crash?
Yeah.
Was it?
I've had three car crashes.
Oh, have you? Yes. Have you not thought about giving up driving?
No. The two others, people died.
Oh, did they?
Yeah,
oh, no.
So that's why I was so upset.
Yeah.
It's standard practice for anyone involved in a road traffic collision to be breathalysed. This is to rule out drink driving as a possible cause of the accident.
One steady blow, you don't have to blow that hard. It's quite sensitive, this one. That's it, keep blowing. That's it. And then the result will come up on screen, which I imagine will be zero. There we go, zero. Thank you very much.
Once the police have carried out their checks and the driver's details have been exchanged, Mandy and Michelle take Elizabeth to Warwick Hospital.
No pins and needles down your legs at all, sir. You can move them all. It's just going to feel a bit tight in your arm, just while I check your blood pressure.
On arrival at the hospital, Elizabeth will be scanned to see if she has any internal injuries. As she was already suffering with back problems, her spine and neck will be x-rayed. This is to check that today's collision hasn't caused any further injuries.
Third accident.
Yeah, she said so when this happened, she was really upset.
I can imagine. She was on the way to a back therapist, wasn't she?
Yeah, she was. But she was a very nice lady.
Yeah.
So are you going to have a sleeve done on that arm then?
Yeah. You're
going to
have
loving
hate on your knuckles.
Loving hate. Mum and Dad. Well, I'm thinking the next one, I'm thinking barbed wire around my neck.
Oh, yeah, I think that would really suit you. Yeah. Suit your vibe.
Yeah.
Having a crewmate that you can have
that rapport with, that you feel like you've got a strong friendship, is a brilliant base prior to going out and working together.
Ambulance service, how can I help? One of our officers has come across a lady that's been struck by a car. She's in a dangerous position on the roadway.
And is she breathing unconscious?
As far as I'm aware, yeah.
Oh, we're going to an RTC, I think.
Wait, where am I going?
4976.
This job came through as car versus pedestrian and major trauma. So on our way to this, we're thinking, how fast was the car going that has hit the patient and what injuries have they sustained?
We are going to an RTC. Coming through as one patient, it's a car versus pedestrian.
We had no idea what injuries were sustained, if the patient was awake, if the patient was unconscious. We've got no idea what was going on with this patient at this moment in time, so you are thinking of worst case scenario.
Having minimal details come through from control can make it difficult because we're unaware of what we're going to be turning up to and how significant the injuries are.
Hello, Rose. You okay? My name's Brad. I'm one of the paramedics with the ambulance service.
In the centre of Birmingham, paramedic Brad and student paramedic Carly have just arrived at the scene of a collision between a car and a pedestrian.
Any pain in your neck or back at the moment? Okay. I am going to have a try and have a little feel, sweetheart.
62-year-old healthcare assistant Rose was on her way home from a night shift at the local hospital when she was hit by a car.
Any pain in your head around here at all? Any, do you feel sick? Any headaches? Any dizziness? Any problems with your vision? Perfect, lovely. Any pain in your chest at all? Any pain in your tummy? Any pain in your arms or arms? Give my hands a squeeze. Perfect, lovely.
The initial assessments that need to be conducted when somebody's been involved in an RTC like Rose has was to ensure that we do a top-to-toe trauma assessment and identify any injuries or any new pain that she's got as a result of the RTC.
Are you able to just roll over that way for me a little bit? If you can't, I can get some help. Where is that painful in your ankle?
Yes, in my ankle.
Any pain?
Yeah.
Any pain at all?
Yeah. Yeah.
Perfect, okay.
So I suspected that Rose had broken her ankle. It was quite swollen, it was very painful to touch. All of them are quite good indications that there could be a possible fracture there.
Only an X-ray in hospital will be able to determine if her ankle is broken.
Right, so what we're going to do first, we're just going to sit you up, OK?
Sit. Get your bearings as you sit. Lovely.
How does that feel?
OK.
All right?
I can't just stand up.
That's fine.
It's
give
right,
us a second.
No rush.
Any pain in your neck at all where I'm pressing?
No.
No? And any pain down your back at all? And if I feel down here, any pain at all?
No.
Any pain at all?
No.
No. Any pain? No. Look to your left. Painful?
No.
Look to me. Painful?
It's going to be painful looking at him.
I can't help everything. Bring your chin to your chest. Any pain?
When you're working at the side of the road, there is that sense of exposure. You're aware that that road is still open. Cars are still travelling past you. There's still the members of public there that are watching on.
Ready, Rose?
Couple of bumps, Rose, all right.
Everything happens so fast, doesn't it, ever with anything like that? Before you know it, you've got a crowd, we're turning out, you've got everyone prodding and poking you.
What I liked about Rose is, no, like, despite what had happened, like, she'd just finished a 12-hour night shift, and she'd been hit by a car and potentially broken her ankle.
She didn't want to bother anyone.
If that was me at the end of a night shift, I'd be like a bear with a sore head, without a doubt.
I'm going to have another look at this leg. All right, let's have a see what we're dealing with. So you've got no pain up in the leg here, it is just this ankle. Lovely, spot on.
Am I okay to take your shoe off?
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. Whereabouts you work, Rose?
Marshall Hall.
Oh, at the hospital there? Yeah. Cool. I'm going to be nice and try and gentle, but this is probably the tightest shoe I've come across.
You're not too painful? On.
No, I've got socks on.
Not too painful? Sure?
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah.
Spot on. How does that ankle look to you?
Fallen.
It looks big to me as well. Any pain up here at all?
Yeah.
It's painful there, is it? I'm looking for any swelling, any obvious deformity, and also I'm going to be feeling for a pulse in that foot to make sure that there's still a good blood circulation to that limb. Cool, so you've got a good pulse in that foot still. Feel me touching there? Yeah. Feel me touching down here? Feel me touching down here? Lovely. And on the bridge here, you can feel me touching? Perfect. Lovely. All right. So, obviously, the ankle is quite swollen. All right. And obviously, there's the reduced movement in there, so there's a chance you have fractured that ankle. So, obviously, we'll pop you up to the hospital. You don't need to go to Majors. All right. Your blood pressure's up a little bit, but all your other observations are normal. Do you suffer with high blood pressure normally? No. We'll give you some paracetamol, OK? Carly's going to lift it up slightly, OK? And I'm going to slide this underneath. I'm not going to lie to you, it's cold. How's COVID affected you at the hospital?
Oh, yeah, badly.
Badly? Never fancied a change in career?
No, I like looking after my patients.
Yeah?
Yeah, I do, actually.
That's nice. Good. Rose was brilliant, to be fair. Lovely, lovely lady. I really enjoyed having a chat with her in the back of the ambulance.
Rose arrives at Birmingham City Hospital, where her ankle injury can be x-rayed and medical staff can determine if she's broken it.
Well done, Rose. And then put your good leg on the floor if you can.
You'd think you'd done this before, Rose.
No, I've just got to try and work this chair out. Shuffle your bum over a bit more, sweet.
More accustomed to caring for patients on a hospital ward, this time Rose is the one who needs looking after.
Is he going front to guide, or are you OK?
I'll let you know in a minute.
There's some L plates for this wheelchair, Rose.
Rose is my favourite patient of the day.
That's a strong call, a 10:45.
No, it's always nice treating one of your own.
Yeah, bless her. I can't believe that's happened to her after a night shift, though.
Like, she's tough. Pedestrian versus cars very rarely go like that, though, do they? The advantage of it was that she's got the rush hour works. Traffic and stuff like that, yeah. If that had been like midday when that road's clear, it could have been a significant job, that could have been.
We do get on very well. I'm very sarcastic towards him. He knows it. I think he secretly loves it. He just doesn't want to admit it.
And I wonder if you know how it really feels.
To be left outside alone.
When it's colder here. Okay, again. See, do you know how I understand that? I understand that from your poor choice of songs.
Patients can sense that we've worked together for a while. I mean, the amount of times we get asked if we're together, I think I'd have thousands of pounds.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yeah, I've had a hypoglycemic episode. Might be a heart attack, I'm not sure.
So you've got some chest pains, have you?
On the left side, lower down.
We've got an 84-year-old male with chest pain.
It's always a worry when we get the call for anyone with chest pain, especially when they're a little bit older, as the risk of cardiovascular disease and other complications can often occur.
Hello. Nice to meet you. I'm Sophie and this is Kyle. So what's been going on today then?
I was in hospital the last week.
Yeah?
With pneumonia.
84-year-old Barry called an ambulance this morning when he experienced pain in his side. His daughter June is with him.
is the pain there now, currently?
Yeah, now, yeah.
All right. And does the pain go anywhere else?
No, it's sort of...
Literally just in that sort of space there? And so just here?
Yeah.
Does it hurt when I press it?
No, it doesn't hurt when you press it.
He states that his pain in his chest is getting worse. This isn't a good sign.
Did you wake up with the pain?
I was already awake.
Okay.
After this heart pain.
Barry has type 1 diabetes, so Kyle and Sophie check his blood sugars.
Turn your hand round for me. You know the routine, I'm sure you've done it many times. How long have you been diabetic for?
Oh,
30-odd
years.
4.7 right now, so we're sitting in a normal range. I'm just going to take your temperature. You feel a tad warm. Just want to make sure you're not baking at all. You're not. That's great. Your blood pressure's very high. We've done a few different blood pressures now. We've tried to get a couple of different readings, and all of them are coming up above 200 systolic, the top number, which is very high.
Yeah.
The systolic reading is over 200, and it's actually the highest I've ever seen.
Ambulance service, is the patient breathing?
Yes. One of our clients has called through. Their daughter's at the house at the moment, and they just can't help her up.
Paramedics Mandy and Michelle are sent to the job.
Right, Mandy, we're going to Warwick. Query stroke.
When the call came through and it said a possible stroke, the things that we need to think about is what symptoms they are having and what time these symptoms started, as we have a time window to be able to get these patients to the stroke hospital.
If treatment is given soon after symptoms first appear, many of the effects of a stroke can be reversed.
It's time critical. We need to get there, get in front of the patient and assess them quickly.
Across the West Midlands, we're on board with eight paramedic crews filming simultaneously to capture life on a 12-hour day shift.
Olive, my name's Michelle. This is Mandy.
Hi, Olive.
You're well snuggied up there, aren't you?
Yes, she's so cold. That's the trouble.
Oh, let me just feel your wrist, darling.
In Warwick, Mandy and Michelle are with 92-year-old Olive, who lives at home. Her daughter Hazel is her primary carer and visits every morning.
Olive, you in any pain anywhere? Not really. Yeah. 39.
When Hazel found her mum disorientated and unable to stand, she called for help.
Have you got a list of your mum's medication?
Yes,
OK, Olive. We're just going to do your blood pressure, darling, OK?
Have you had your hair done, Olive?
Hey?
Have you had your hair done?
Yesterday.
No, nice.
Good job it was yesterday.
Olive did seem confused when we were talking to her. Her daughter was able to fill us in a lot of information that we were missing.
Is that her meds?
That's the list, but there's also that one.
Does she sleep in that chair then, does she?
She did last night because she's got her chair lift. She phoned me up last night saying, I can't get on the chair, I can't get on it.
Do you have any carers come in, Olive?
My daughter come in, are
you? Oh, bless her.
Olive's daughter was explaining that she'd become mum's main carer. It's quite common nowadays for the roles to be reversed, and more family members are now looking after their parents and do find it very difficult.
Just been speaking to the daughter. She's really upset because she does everything. If we don't take mum in, then we'll get the frailty team and they can assess for carers. Any pain anywhere, Olive? No, none in your tummy? Yeah. OK. Eating and drinking OK? OK, so you just feel as weak as a kitten at the moment?
Yeah.
OK. You've obviously got an infection somewhere.
With no facial droop or limb weakness, Mandy and Michelle can rule out a stroke. But it's still unclear what's causing Olive to be so unwell.
Right, let's just do one more blood pressure, Olive.
But this last week, she's just suddenly gone downhill again, rapidly.
Yeah. But I think even if she does curl up,
You still need to get that relationship back to mother and daughter, don't you, rather than fraud.
Relax back a sec.
I'd say in our job it's about 50-50 that we see where the children are struggling to look after parents. I think it's hard for anybody to accept a role reversal in life. It is difficult to accept some situations, but once you've accepted it, you can start enjoying the relationship again.
We need to get your temperature down.
We don't want anybody coming out unnecessary.
Is it just you?
Yeah.
They're not supposed to get old, are they, mums?
No.
At all? No. I used to think about my nan. My nan always looked the same age. The daughter's taking on the role as Olive's main carer, so has taken on the role as mum and not really the situation people want to find themselves in.
It's estimated that 5 million people in the UK are juggling caring responsibilities with work. That's 1 in 7 of the workforce. And the majority are women.
Right, Olive. What we're going to do is stand you up. Might as well use your trolley. And we just want you to turn around and pop your bottom on this chair. Now, it's a bit of a weird chair because it's got no arms, Olive.
You're just going to have to trust us.
Yeah. Huh?
If I don't sit still,
I'll roll up. Absolutely. Yeah. And then we get told off again. It's just to help get you out to the ambulance, and then we can get you on our stretcher, Olive.
Right, stand there, Olive, and we'll get your skirt sorted.
No matter what patient we go out to and their age, it's important that we treat them with dignity. If it was my family member, I'd want them to be treated that way, so it's important that I do that with the patients I go out to.
Yeah. Thank you.
As Mandy and Michelle believe Olive has an infection, she needs to go to hospital to be checked over.
Do you want to say goodbye to Mum?
Did you want to come on and say?
Yeah.
But talk to the hospital as well while she's in there about help and stuff before they let her go in. Oh, you've got no choice, Olive, have you?
Thank you so much.
You've got no choice, Olive, have you? But to
have
do
a nice
told.
Cup of tea, Hazel.
Due to COVID restrictions, daughter Hazel won't be allowed into the hospital and has to stay at home.
Happy, Michelle?
Yes, thank you. Ready when you are.
I might have to take my coat off.
Because Hazel is starting to struggle, we're going to refer you to social services to get a review, get her a bit more help, and you a bit more help. And then the time that you're together, you can just sit and have a cup of tea and nap her.
We got all of the treatment that she needed by taking her to hospital for a diagnosis and treatment, but we're also able to help her daughter, who was emotionally and physically exhausted from looking after her mom.
We're there now.
Mandy and Michelle arrive at Warwick Hospital, where doctors will run tests to diagnose and treat Olive's infection. This is the 1,418th call so far today, and the shift is far from over.
If I pop some leads on your chest, make sure the ticker's doing what it should. Did you have an ambulance last week?
Yeah.
So our system allows us to see what past ambulances have found. Let's have a look at his blood pressure from last week.
18 miles away in Birmingham, paramedic Kyle and technician Sophie are treating Barry. He's got stomach pains and has the highest blood pressure Kyle's ever seen.
Sort of highest they got was 101 systolic.
So I bet he's been taken off antihypertensives. The unfortunate side now is you're at currently 242 as the top number. When the ambulance came to see you last week, it was between 90 and 100.
Yeah.
So it's more than doubled. And that's too high, unfortunately.
Yeah,
we found out that Barry's been taken off his blood pressure medication. This could well be the reason why it's so high. At first glance, though, Good news, your heart's doing what it should from what we can see right now.
Good. A normal blood pressure is around 120. At over 200, Barry's is dangerously high.
Can I have a quick listen to your chest?
Yeah.
Yeah? Perfect. Thank you very, very much. Perfect. Any pain
That's
there?
That's where it's beginning, yeah.
Sort of here?
No.
So when I'm pressing here, does the pain come up to where you're pointing?
Yeah.
So when I'm pressing on the sort of left lower?
So what medication do you normally take for pain then? Is it paracetamol?
Kind of
you can take your morning meds.
Yeah.
And then we'll figure out the best plan from there.
The hospital, they stopped you taking the Ramipril?
Yeah.
Okay. What? Have they advised?
When I went in there, my blood pressure was low.
Okay.
Now it's high again.
He knew what he needed to take, when he needed to take it, what it was for.
He was organised, right?
I was very impressed.
Because they said it was his heart, and I thought, what do I do?
Yeah, no.
He said,
no,
I think I'm having an heart attack.
He's got half a pharmacy here, and he knows what he's taking when he's taking.
He said to them.
Yeah. I said, I wouldn't know what to do and when to take them.
No.
There'd be too many for me. I have to write a list. Fine at the minute, but obviously, we just need to sort that blood pressure out. Thing.
Yeah.
And then potentially just some pain relief just for the
They won't be going to hospital, will they?
I mean the choice is totally up to him. I mean we would advise it only because if he's complaining of left sided abdominal pain we sort of need that in sort of investigating.
Still there, it might be just indigestion.
Kyle and Sophie want to take Barry to hospital to get his high blood pressure treated and his abdominal pain investigated.
We're going to the Queen Elizabeth to the QE.
I've got to go there.
The posh hospital.
You've got to win this.
I've got to have all the boys.
We charge extra for another passenger.
It was really nice to see how supportive Barry's family were.
Don't you, love?
All right.
You take care, Grandad.
No,
don't you get upset. You're the one
who
gets upset.
All right. Lovely to meet you all, OK? He's in good hands. We'll take good care of him, OK?
You take care, Grandad.
I mean, I'd like to think that going off with us, he's in safe hands. If anything was to happen, we're the guys for the job.
It's getting a bit stronger now. But this time I was in, another diabetic nurse came who was much better.
Okay.
She's suggesting a change, lowering melanthus in the morning, giving me a quick acting short thing in the evening.
Okay. So there is sort of a little plan in place. We just sort of need to get it.
Yeah.
Get it sorted.
I think for Barry, there were lots of things that had been going on for a little while, but hopefully we managed to solve a couple of the issues.
But what we'll do when we get there, I just want to check your blood sugars just once more.
School?
Was that your old school?
King Edward, yeah.
Wow. Is it still, does it still look the same as when you were there?
I've added to it since.
Oh, I've added to it.
I was 53 when I left.
Oh, really? Not long ago then?
No, not long ago.
Did you enjoy school?
Yeah.
Oh, lovely. And did you enjoy doing that?
I did, yeah.
It's always good to find a job that you like.
Yeah, that's true.
So we're just pulling in,
OK? Yes,
I think so. Kyle and Sophie arrive at Queen Elizabeth Hospital in Birmingham.
So Kyle's just going to go and get you booked in at the hospital. If there is room in there, we'll take you straight through. If not, you'll be sort of in our care until there's room, OK?
Here, Barry will have x-rays taken of his abdomen, blood tests and a more detailed tracing of his heart.
We've got a chair just here for you then. I'll take that. Right, Sophie, you'll get you comfy with the blanket.
You back up in the blanket so you're nice and warm, all right. Comfortable? Brilliant.
genuinely, that's one of the highest blood pressures I've ever seen. Like, nearly 250 systolic. Incredible. Especially, like, 4 days ago, it was between 90 and 100 systolic. So,
yeah.
Taking off that medication he was on has definitely made a big difference.
I think it just shows, doesn't it, like, the positive effects of medication and the reason why people are given them. You know, from, you know, 6 days, he's gone from being, you know, not
a blood pressure of 90 systolic
to, you know, a blood pressure of nearly 250.
The risks of that are huge.
Ambulance service, patient conscious and breathing.
They are, yeah.
So can I help?
I'd like to arrange an ambulance, please, for a patient I've just spoken to. I'm a GP. So she's on chemotherapy and she had a temperature and she's short of breath.
We are going to a 74-year-old female coming through as very neutropenic sepsis. It looks like she had recent chemo. She's got a high temperature and is short of breath.
This job came through as suspected sepsis from a referral from the patient's GP. So it was important that we got to her as soon as possible.
Sepsis is a life-threatening reaction where there's been an infection in the body which is now spread. Can lead to multi-organ failure. If left without the antibiotics, the patient's life is in danger.
Breathe.
You're struggling with your breathing?
Okay. How long has that been bothering you?
Well, particularly since
Sunday. Since Sunday, okay. And what's changed today, sweetheart?
I've had enough.
In Birmingham, Carly and Brad are with 74-year-old Anne. When recent chemotherapy treatment for lung cancer left her fighting for breath, her GP rang for an ambulance. Anne's husband, Mike, is with her.
Are you bringing anything up at all with your cough?
Phlegm. Sort of creamy, you know.
Green or yellow in colour? Not that you tend to stare at it for longer than you need to, but...
Milky.
OK. Can you just have a little feel of your wrist, sweetheart?
Okay. Yes, the ultimate this morning was that. I thought... No good.
Can I have a little listen to your chest a minute, Anne? Is that okay? I'm going to come up your top if you don't mind. Knowing that Anne has lung cancer and she's had recent chemotherapy does put her at higher risk of contracting sepsis. But our main priority at this moment was how fast her heart rate was going.
You've got no temperature, so it's 37.1. So that's okay, that is, but not just let Carly have a listen a sec.
After feeling for her pulse, it was very quickly apparent that her pulse was racing.
Nice and still, Anne, no moving, no talking.
Which can be a really big indicator of sepsis. I'm thinking this patient could be really poorly. The average adult heart rate should be between 60 beats to 100 beats per minute. Anne's was in the realms of 180 to 190. The heart's not designed to go that quick. There is a risk that this heart might stop.
We're moving quite quickly, Anne, because your heart rate's quite quick. Can we get stretched to the front door, please, if possible? There's nothing to worry about, but we're just going to get you to a doctor relatively quickly, sweetheart, all right? There's nothing to be frightened of at all, sweetheart.
The way me and Carly work, she'll know when I'm bothered or worried. My energy changes, I start moving quicker. It's because I'm concentrating, I'm thinking, and I'm wondering what I'm going to do next, and I'm planning the patient's treatment here.
Sharp scratch.
You're good.
Brad fits a cannula to Anne's arm. This allows him to give drugs directly into her bloodstream.
And because her heart rate's going so quickly, I give her some IV paracetamol, which can help bring that temperature down a little bit, which may ease that heart rate as well.
Tell me about your COPD and emphysema again. Have you got diagnosed COPD?
The doctor has mentioned it. They just said it was probably certainly aggravated by radiotherapy.
COPD is a lung condition that makes breathing more difficult.
There's your bag, Anne.
Anne had quite a complex past medical history. She also suffers with breathing condition. So I have to ascertain whether this is normal for the patient or is this abnormal.
It's an 8-minute drive to Good Hope Hospital. On the journey, Brad gives Anne oxygen and monitors her condition.
How you doing, sweet? You all right?
Yeah.
Sure?
Yeah. Don't like the mask.
You don't like it? Let's take it off then. Is that better? Yeah. Do you feel poorly now?
Just absolutely lousy.
All right.
And it's not being able to breathe.
Still think that she didn't realise how poorly she was. She maintained an element of dignity and almost self-reassurance.
At the hospital, doctors will investigate why Anne's breathing has suddenly deteriorated. They'll also review her medication to see if any changes could help her condition. It's nearly the end of the paramedic's day shift. As they won't start again until tomorrow night, the evening is all theirs.
What's your plans tonight? Friday night?
I think I'm going to do shopping, which I really didn't want to do.
Sounds like a good Friday night, that does. Friday night in the supermarket.
Friday night is well spent in the supermarket.
Oh dear, that's when we know we're getting old.
I feel like we've had a busy day.
We have actually, I haven't stopped today.
Yeah, lovely patients, busy day.
And it's been lovely. The sun shone, there was ice on the road this morning, it's rained, everybody's lived. And yeah, we're not going to Corinders.
Always a bonus. Yeah. Bonus. Happy days.
Yeah. What are you having for tea tonight?
I think it's going to the curry house.
Oh, you did say, yeah.
Shookers. So I think I've got a lamb roast and just a full roast.
You done all right today?
I've lovely patients.
What are you doing tonight?
I mean, I
going
expect
to bed
you
at 8
can
o'clock?
Guess. Yeah, I'm going to
get
go
in, cup of tea, shower, bed at 8.
Yeah. Alright, cool. I'm so boring, it's unreal.
It's a Friday night, why are you not going out? I'm going out, yeah, I'm going to the pub. Signed off.
See ya.
See ya tomorrow. That is me done.
Investigations revealed Anne was suffering from pneumonia. She was treated in hospital with antibiotics and is now back at home recovering. Olive, who had an infection, was found to have ulcers on her legs and received treatment in hospital. She now has 4 carers visiting each day, which also gives daughter Hazel some much-needed respite. Elizabeth, who was involved in a road traffic collision, had x-rays carried out on her back. No injuries were found, and she was discharged the same day. Barry, who was taken to hospital with dangerously high blood pressure, was later diagnosed with bronchopneumonia. Sadly, 5 days later, Barry passed away in hospital. His daughter June was by his side. Anne Rose, who was hit by a car following her night shift, had surgery on her broken ankle and is now recovering at home.
I was making my way home and I was crossing the road, and next thing I know, I got hit by a car. I was lying on the ground, paramedics were called. When the paramedics arrived, I did feel really relieved because I felt like, you know, they were there to support me. It was a lot of pain. It was a lot of pain, you know, because I couldn't put my foot down on the ground. When they put me onto the stretcher, they took me into the ambulance. I was in hospital for 4 days. as a healthcare assistant, this experience was to help me to relate to my patients more and to understand their needs and what they are going through.
Next time.
It's getting worse.
A 90-year-old man has stabbing chest pains.
He did turn around and say that if we thought it was something serious, we were not to save him, which really pulls at your heartstrings.
Shut your eyes for me. Shut your eyes.
Paramedics treat a suspected stroke.
As soon as she started talking to us, we knew that there was something serious going on.
Who's with you, Marion?
Was she on her own?
OK.
And a bad fall gives paramedics cause for concern.
Are they on blood thinners and are there any other injuries from the fall?